Well, first I'd like to, of course, thank the Monroe Institute for inviting me again. This place has become a little bit like a second home to me in the last 5 years. Since 5 years now, it's hard to believe I've been doing or conducting and training the out-of-body intensive workshop, which is a 6-day workshop here at the Monroe Institute. And it's been an incredible experience of my life, really, because as many of you know, this is the premier facility in the world for the exploration of consciousness. I mean, there's no doubt of this. Where else can you go to an institute and receive not only top-notch training from people who know what they're talking about, but also have individual check units where you can explore on your own, not in some, you know, collective on the floor. I remember 25 years ago when I started doing workshops, it was be in a little hall, basically, and everybody be laying on mats. And I'd have a little boom box on the corner. And that's the way we did workshops 20, 25 years ago. And boy, here it's come full circle. Now it's very high tech, very sophisticated, using the very finest of sound technology, Hemi-Sync and other technologies to assist people to go into altered, deep, deep altered states quickly, so that we can truly become the explorers we're meant to be. Because the answers are only found in the exploration of consciousness. We here know this, but so many today do not. They still depend on belief systems. They still depend on, let's just say, external man-made philosophies for guidance. And as any explorer of consciousness knows, we have the capability, all of us individually, we possess the capability to obtain the answers ourselves. And this is one of the things I like to talk about today. For the next hour and a half, I'd like for you to open your mind to a broader perception of reality. Open your mind to a whole new concept of what you are and where you're headed and your whole evolutionary cycle. Because unfortunately, humanity, all 7 billion of us, have been indoctrinated with two very false narratives. We've been indoctrinated, and I'm one of those people that was indoctrinated from birth also. The two narratives are this, and they're steeply, deeply placed in our subconscious minds. One of them, of course, is that consciousness is nothing but a byproduct of a biological brain. That consciousness is a result of these electromagnetic signals that are going on in our biological brain. This, of course, is a false narrative. We're much more than this, as we know. The second false narrative is that we are powerless, even possibly sinful creatures that cannot obtain the answers for ourselves, and we must depend upon belief systems to guide us throughout our lives. These two false narratives have had a tremendous negative impact upon the evolution of humanity. And the vast majority of the 7 billion people on one level have bought into these false narratives. The opposite is actually the truth. We possess the ability to obtain the answers, to explore our true self, to absolutely obtain the knowledge and the insights that we need to accelerate our personal evolution. We have the ability to move beyond all of the indoctrination that's so rampant in our society and culture. But it's up to us to make that decision. We must open our minds. And the first step to opening our minds is to ask yourself an important question. Simply this: what would you believe today? What would you believe today if you were born in Iran or Pakistan or China? What flag would you defend? What religion would you be a member of? Obviously, it would be totally different than today. We must remember this. We are a product of cultural and society's indoctrination from the moment we're born. And we have to become open-minded enough to examine our own state of consciousness and determine where we're headed. What beliefs do we hold that are holding us back? Because I and others have found there's nothing external. There's nothing out there stopping us from obtaining the answers. We do by what we choose to believe. So we have to look deep inside ourselves and determine what is reality. Where am I headed? Think of this for a moment. 7 billion people on the planet, and we don't know where we're headed at this pivotal transition of consciousness we call death. Think of it. We're on this 80, 90-year-old journey, and we have no idea. It's kind of a form of insanity. We have everything planned. Tomorrow, tonight, you know exactly what you're going to do. Tomorrow, you know exactly what you're going to do. But here, an entire species has no idea what's going to happen at the moment this transition of consciousness occurs. That's unacceptable. It's insanity. It's a form of amnesia. We also, when you think about it, dig deep, we don't even know what we are. And I'm going to explore this in a moment. We don't know where we come from as consciousness before we were born, do we? We're suddenly here, we accept the culture and the society we're given, and we do the best we can. And then we connect to and adapt to the social norms and hope that they're correct, hope to some give us solace, some of us give us hope, some of us, but there's no answers given. That I find completely unacceptable because as powerful spiritual beings, we have the ability to obtain the answers for ourselves, but we have to become explorers of consciousness. It's up to us individually to learn the methods, the techniques, so we can explore deeply within ourselves, because all the answers, there's the old X-Files, I believe it was, said the answers are out there. Totally false. The answers are in here. The answers are in here for us to find. They're never separated. They're always within us. But we have to find a method or methods that's effective for us to explore consciousness. And for different people, it's different things. Some people, it's deep meditation. Other people, it's deep forms of yoga. For other people, it's out-of-body exploration. For some people, it could be lucid dreaming and shamanic practices. Different methods appeal to different people. And we have to be open enough to explore these for ourselves and no longer break free. Most of humanity have become pawns of belief systems. Pawns. We no longer need to do this. We can break free. And that's what I like to talk about tonight. Give you a little bit of background. I'm the author of 3 books. I've been exploring out-of-body experiences for the last 40 years. It's become my passion and my life's work, essentially. And it's exciting, because it's exciting. Discovery is exciting. Self-discovery is incredibly exciting. That's why so many people return every year to the Monroe Institute, because they discover new things about themselves in all the various wonderful programs that are conducted here. Just to give you a little bit of background on myself, I'm the trainer for the 6-day workshop that focuses on the preparation and mindset to achieving out-of-body states of consciousness, or shifts of consciousness beyond the limits of our body. Starting this year, I will also conduct a new workshop called Destination Higher Self, which is a 3-day event which basically covers the preparation, detailed preparation, and insight into how to prepare yourself and your loved ones for the afterlife journey that we all share. We're all on this journey together, and there's no avoiding it. We're going to make this transition. Let's make it with the most knowledge and insight we can. The time that humanity is clueless is over. The answers are available. And that's what I like to talk about tonight. What have we learned from 40 years of documented NDEs and OBEs? We have learned a tremendous amount. There's dozens of dedicated, well-respected researchers have been exploring and researching near-death experiences for many decades now. They've compiled amazing results and insights. I have focused on the OBE, and myself and others have investigated that. 15 years ago, I did a survey where 17,000 people responded about their OBEs. In other words, and just to clarify, in other words, experiences beyond the body. For some of you that don't know, an NDE is generally caused by a trauma of some kind, and it's generally a short experience, 4 minutes or less. OBEs open up a whole new realm because they can be extended and repeated, and that's what makes them so valuable. There's no time limit. You can repeat an OBE every night if you have the proper training and explore your non-physical reality. These are the two workshops that I've done, but what have we learned? And I just want to cover this because it's a tremendous amount. And I'm going to just cut to the core here. We have been indoctrinated to believe, of course, that the biological brain is a source of consciousness. But yet, NDEs, millions and millions of NDEs and OBEs prove that this is a false assumption and conclusion, completely false. We, through these millions of experiences, we know that we continue to exist. This is the baseline. We know we continue to exist and function beyond the body. This is a fact. We can think and function. We continue to think and function. This is an important point because this blows out of the water the entire philosophy of the physical scientists that prove that all thought and reasoning is a biological function. OBEs and NDEs, of course, prove that to be totally false. What's interesting is we are entering another reality when we have an out-of-body experience and a near-death experience. It operates by different rules. We do not breathe air. We are using a different kind of energy body. We're reasoning, we're functioning, we're thinking logically, but yet there's no biological brain. So we're using a different form of energy, essentially. We can, and this has been proven, enter and exit our physical body without physical death occurring. I personally have been having OBEs for 40 years. I can't count. There's so many. There's not only can we exit our physical body in full consciousness, but we can prolong the experience with training, with knowledge. We can learn to extend our state of consciousness separated from the body for long periods of time. I've talked to many of the authors today, probably most of them that have written books on these subjects of on the subject of OBEs, and they all agree with me. Not only can we function, but we can function for extended periods of time while separated from the body. There's no question of this. I and others have spent over an hour from my biological body from our bodies, fully functional. Matter of fact, you're more aware, not less, more aware. You have more capabilities. And we'll cover that in a moment. What does this tell us about ourselves? What does this show us about our true reality? Like I said, we've been indoctrinated from birth to believe a lot of stuff. And up to the, let's say, the end of this, of the past century, most people had to believe it because they had no other source of information. We had to buy into the belief systems because we didn't have a choice. Now we do. Now the knowledge and the insight is coming forth. Our natural environment is a non-physical environment. Birth and death, as we see it, as we experience it, is just the exit and entrance of our conscious awareness into this playing field of matter. It's a temporary experience that we're using. And we are capable of existing and exploring in many different dimensional realities. What I and others have discovered through time and time again is that the physical world is the thin outer epidermis of the universe. When we have an NDE or an OBE, the term out of body is really a misnomer, because what we're actually doing is shifting our consciousness from the outer biological brain to the inner vibrational energy body that we all already possess. We're moving inward into the more subtle substructure or core of the universe. This universe, this physical universe, is a tiny, tiny fraction of the totality of the universe that exists. Matter of fact, it's so small in comparison, it's beyond my words even make a statement. It's like a balloon, and the outer skin, the outer elastic, is the physical. When people die, when they have OBEs and NDEs, they're shedding the epidermis layer, they're shedding the chrysalis, and they're moving inward into this multidimensional universe that we all share. Unfortunately, because of a lack of knowledge for thousands of years, many belief systems have given this non-physical reality these terms that are now part of our culture, which is heaven, paradise. I mean, they're basically nondescript terms of a non-physical reality that was difficult to describe, and I understand that. These concepts are difficult because the rules of the road of non-physical reality are totally different than the rules of matter. And often we forget this. We try to use our physical concepts of reality and apply them to a non-physical state. It doesn't work. It just adds to confusion to the whole topic, which of course leads to the entire flawed concepts that now are so dominant in our society, which is this concept of paradise and heaven, and that everyone just goes to this place. I mean, it's actually quite childish. Millions and millions of out-of-body and near-death experiences prove that there's multiple realities that people experience, countless realities, and the result of consciousness. And when we have these experiences, we're experiencing another aspect of ourselves. We're exploring another aspect of ourselves that already exists, because we are a microcosm of the entire universe. Our bodies is just the outer layer, the thin outer epidermis of this. Another thing that I like to point out, and this is not well known by many people. As an out-of-body explorer myself, and had the opportunity of talking and training people to have these experiences, I know for a fact that as we prolong our out-of-body state of consciousness, our humanoid form begins, and there's no really descriptive way to put this except dissolve. When I have an out-of-body experience, the longer that I hold that state of consciousness, my arms and my legs will begin to dissolve away. My torso will dissolve away until I become a pinpoint of consciousness with 360-degree vision. I and others that have out-of-body experience, we don't see this animal vision. We see through our true vision. Call it our expanded state of consciousness or call it soul, whatever label you want to give it. But that's what we really are. We are not only non-physical, we are evolving into a non-humanoid, because that's truly what we are. We are immortal. We're a non-physical species, non-humanoid species, using form as a tool for our evolution and exploration purposes. Because you need a biological body to experience the biological world, just like you need a non-physical body or an astral body, let's say, to experience the astral dimension. You need a vehicle of consciousness that resonates in the same vibratory range so you can be effective to explore it, to experience it. So, the bottom line, we are not even human. We're consciousness, pure consciousness, using forms for our evolution. And what's amazing is that how do we evolve? We learn, grow, and evolve by becoming that which we wish to learn. I could read 1,000 books about being a woman in the 20th century. I would never get it, would I, as a man? Never would I. I think all the ladies would agree. But become a woman one time, one incarnation as a woman, I bet I got it down pretty good. I bet I finally understand what it's like. This is how our species evolves. We become what we wish to learn. We use biological vehicles as tools of our consciousness, as tools of our exploration, as tools of our evolution as a non-physical species. We have been fed so many false narratives about our evolutionary cycle. We are evolving through form. We're using form. And this is an important difference. This is what, in many ways, our self-identity is what blocks us in many ways in our personal evolutionary process. Think about it. As long as you identify yourself as a male or female human at death, how can we possibly, with that anchor, possibly move to the higher vibrational levels in the thought responsive universes beyond, or dimensions beyond the astral? Many people are always looking for beliefs, believe this and believe that, but it's the opposite. Beliefs end up being the anchors that hold us. Not the salvation, it's the anchor that holds us to the form-based realities of the lower dimensional. And there's endless dimensions as far as we can tell. But we have to look at ourselves, because there's nothing outside of us. Because we are the path. We are the inner journey home. Just for a moment, I want to talk about something that's seldom addressed. There's a lot of talk everywhere about heaven, paradise, non-physical reality. We hear about it constantly everywhere. And often it's distorted beyond belief. It's like these concepts of heaven that I hear about, you know, it's like, I just cringe. Strip away the belief systems for a moment. What do we know about non-physical reality that is our potential home? This is it. A non-physical reality would have no molecular mass, so there would be no gravity. When we die, there is no air. There's no biological bodies. If there's no biological bodies, you have no senses. You have no physical senses. You're perceiving your reality in a completely different way. All of the rules of the road that we have learned in our physical lives become meaningless chatter because they no longer apply. The rules of physics have changed. Everybody talks now about the rules of physics and this and that. None of that matters once you make the transition of consciousness and move to your non-physical. There's no mass. There's no molecular decay, so there's no aging. This is why psychics talk about all of these communications with the dead, about people who are younger. Often they're younger. I have witnessed that with my communication that I've had with my dead mother when I met her and my dead uncle. They were in their prime. They were 70 or 80 years old. When I saw them, they looked like they were in their prime, 20, 22, 23 years old. Because their self-concept molded their non-physical body, which is very subtle. So we have to learn the new rules of our real reality, our full-time reality, the reality we're all headed towards. We have to relearn the rules of the road. There is no molecular decay. There is no linear time, as far as myself and others can. There's no aging. The concepts are meaningless. A non-physical body does not age. And of course, there's no death as we know it. And what really gets interesting, and one of the reasons I feel that we're all here, is to learn how to become creative and mold our reality. Non-physical reality is much more subtle than the physical world. Our thoughts have much more impact and creative. We can create our reality in the physical, but it's a slowed down process in the dense molecular world of matter. It's slowed down severely. When we enter these altered states, either the out of body, suddenly you become far more powerful because the reality is much more subtle and your thoughts can mold that reality much faster. It's an amazing difference. Any shaman will tell you this is the truth. Anybody that's done deep explorations of consciousness will tell you this is the absolute truth. As we explore inward, into the true nature of reality, the reality becomes less and less dense and more thought responsive. And there's a reason for this, I and others have found. This is a slowed down training ground for consciousness. Think about it. What's the purpose for all of us, 7 billion of us on this rock spinning on the edge of a galaxy? What is the reason for it? Everybody talks about it as a training ground. But maybe it's more than that. Maybe it's much more than that. Imagine this. What would the ideal paradise be? Everybody talks about these phrases. They use these terms, paradise and heaven. What would it be? Would it be potentially instantly thought responsive? Would it not? If this progression of consciousness is what all of the out-of-body explorers have talked about for the last 100 years, that's one thing everybody agrees on. The universe becomes more and more thought responsive. So, what's the purpose for all of us being on this dense reality? Think of it for a moment. Just for a moment, imagine. If you were in a true paradise where everything is instantly thought responsive, who would you want standing next to you? It's a little scary, isn't it? Who has the self-control and spiritual maturity to be the perfect person next to you in an instant thought responsive universe? Just, or call it the higher heavens. Who would you want next to you? You would want somebody that is very spiritually mature, wouldn't you not? You would want somebody that knows the rules of the road. You would want somebody that has experience. You would want somebody that knows all of the principles of non-physical energy. You would want to be around somebody who is at least equal to yourself. Where would you put the developing children of the universe until they develop this immense ability to have total control over every thought, every creative inclination they may have? Would you not place these developing states of consciousness into a slowed down molecular reality that is so slowed down, in fact, so dense that most people can't even perceive that their creative thoughts are having an impact on their reality? You would put the developing states of consciousness, souls, call them what you will, you would place them in an environment where they could do no harm to the truly evolved. You'd put them in a reality, potentially, where they're also cloistered from the highly evolved. Think of it. Would not the earth make the perfect place? Or the astral? These form-based realities? Just something to think about. Something to think about. This is why we have to learn the rules of non-physical reality, because this is where we're all headed. There's no escaping this. We're all going to be non-physical. Nobody's going to escape this. So let's learn about it. Let's no longer be pawns of belief systems. Let's discover the truth of our reality. Let's discover the inner path within ourselves. Let's become self-empowered spiritually, that we discover the answers for ourselves and no longer have to depend on external anything for advice or answers, because we have that capability. We possess it. We're hardwired to obtain it all. These are some of the principles that we will encounter. Thought is a form of energy, and focused thought creates reality. The more, the higher the non-physical reality, let's use the word higher or inner, the less dense the reality, the faster the restructuring will occur. I know this from experience. That's why we have to be mature, because not only are our positive thoughts create reality, our negative thoughts will create reality. This is where these concepts of the devils and demons came from. People were having altered states of consciousness and encountering their own thought forms. The shamans know this. It's no secret to them. We create everything in a non-physical reality, good, bad, or indifferent. We are the creative force there. And we have to be empowered to understand that and then begin our own personal journey of exploration to learn how to control our own inner creative force. The less dense the environment, the faster the restructuring of all energy realities occur. The effectiveness and speed which thought restructures any energy environment is determined by the intensity of the thought and the density of the environment. That's why the physical world is slow. It's dense. It takes focus to create reality here. When we have an OBE, things change. When we have a near-death experience, things change. Because we've entered into a far more subtle reality. It's far easier to mold with our own thoughts. Self-empowerment begins with the realization that you create it. There's no external thing that's manipulating you unless you allow it to. You decide the anchors. You decide what's holding you back by what you choose to believe. Now, what I'm going to show you is a crude representation of something that's almost impossible to describe. If this was really the entire physical and non-physical universe, this grid, the physical world would be this big, and the non-physical would reach into eternity, just to put it in perspective. Here we are in the physical world. When people have OBEs, they enter often the parallel world and they see a reflection or the substructure. At death, what people often do is they enter into what is commonly today called the astral. I don't like the term, but it's stuck. It's the next major dimensional reality. At death, many people enter the astral. And they enter into what I call consensus realities. Reality is created by collective thought by groups. And when you die, when any of us die, and we're reunited with our loved ones, what have we just done? You have just entered into another collective. And by accepting their presence, by reuniting with them, and I'm not speaking about good, bad, or indifferent. Just think about the logistics. You have entered this other non-physical reality, and you have accepted it as your own. In doing so, it has become yours. The problem is that the vast majority of humanity at death is only moving this far. They're moving a fraction into the vast spectrum of consciousness that is the universe. This is how far we're moving at death, when there's so much more available. And we do it because of lack of knowledge. The belief systems have not prepared us for this continuum of realities that exist, this spectrum that exists. And often we will settle for what appears first, or what is convenient or comfortable to us. Something to consider for now on. Because this is very important. What's the end result? We've moved this much into the universe at death. And for those who doubt my words, who say, oh no, Bill, your fault, this can't be right. Everybody goes to heaven. Heaven is, oh, it's just beyond our scope. If this is true, then why can thousands and thousands of psychics still have contact with loved ones? Why? Because they're standing next to you. They haven't went very far. If a psychic can still have contact with your loved ones, what does that say about it? It sure doesn't say that they've moved to the inner magnificent dwelling points beyond all physical reality, beyond all form-based reality. It's an indication of how close they really are. And they're close because they have accepted a false self-identity of themselves. As long as you believe that you are a human male or a human female, you will continue to enter a consensus reality that far into the universe that is inhabited by others that believe the same thing. This is why the exploration of consciousness is so important, whether it be through deep meditation or through OBEs, or it doesn't matter how you do it. Those of you that have practiced deep meditation know what it feels like when you begin to lose all association with your form. I've talked to many meditators. I've done presentations at meditation groups and societies and conferences. And they all agree to this. As we move inward, we lose our humanoid form. We become, for lack of a better word, pure conscious awareness, which is our natural state of being. But until we accept this, we will always, in a sense, condemn ourselves to the form-based realities. And I'm not the only one who says this. Throughout Buddhism, the entire process of Buddhism calls this journey of consciousness from the physical to the astral and then back to the physical. What is it called? Billions of Hindus and Buddhists call it the wheel. That's what we're doing. No one has a gun to our head in the non-physical realities. It's our own attachments that are driving us. It's our own flawed self-conception that's driving us back to a body. We have to always remember this. For us to become self-empowered, we have to begin to look at ourselves and our entire reality from an entirely different perspective. Forget about these belief systems that are now dominate our society. They're flawed. They're inhibiting our growth, our spiritual growth, our intellectual growth. What hinders the spiritual evolution of all of humanity? Flawed man-made beliefs and institutional indoctrination. It's everywhere. I'm not exempt. I was born and indoctrinated with the best of them. I know what that feels like. It takes courage to start to ask the tough questions, doesn't it? It takes courage to break free from belief systems that are so incredibly entrenched in our global societies. God knows we all have seen what can happen when these belief systems run amok, without going into detail. How incredibly evil they can become. We have all been the result of indoctrination, and it takes courage for us to face it and begin to really re-examine our own state of consciousness. It takes guts to do that. It takes guts to really examine yourself and go, why do I believe this? There's no evidence to support it. Just because my mother believed it doesn't mean I need to. It takes guts to break free from the consensus that is so domineering. What hinders us? A flawed physical self-concept. I've already covered that. As long as we believe that we are male and female humans, we have chained ourselves essentially to a reality that we will continue to carry on that energy form. We will continue to carry that false self-identity. We will also continue to accept the first physical-like reality we experience after death. Isn't this what people do? The Tibetan Book of the Dead talks about this in detail. About going beyond the illusions of form. They call it the illusions. The projections of form. This has been talked about for 1,000 years. But most of us in the West are so incredibly indoctrinated into our multiple belief systems, we still have a hard time breaking free. What also lacks, there is a lack of accurate knowledge about the afterlife. Unfortunately, we color it with our beliefs. We're wearing glasses, rose-colored glasses, when we look at reality, when we look at our beliefs. They are influencing us in many, many negative ways. Many, for especially the fear-based beliefs that are absolutely everywhere in our society. And of course, the absence of knowledge concerning our spiritual evolution through matter. We are powerful, spiritual, non-physical beings using biological vehicles for tools of our exploration and development. That's all they are, biological tools. To be truly prepared for our afterlife journey, it is essential that we become effective explorers of consciousness now. It's up to us, us alone. We have to break free from the belief systems that dominate our society and our culture. I don't care how ingrained they are. Often the older they are, the more flawed they are. Because all beliefs, think, they're all made by man. Anything made by man is flawed. Anything made by man. And don't take my word for it. Become an explorer of consciousness yourself. And discover this for yourself. I don't expect anybody to even believe me. It's up to us individually. We have to have the courage to break free, to become truly open-minded. Everybody tells me, I've been around for a couple decades talking about out-of-body experiences and teaching different techniques. And everybody tells me they're open-minded. Nobody thinks they're indoctrinated. But yet, when you begin to dig deep, you discover, yes, I have been deeply influenced by these multiple layers of beliefs. Each belief that we hold is an anchor holding us to the density of matter and form. The reason that true spiritual growth is often a challenge is because we make it so. We make it so by what we choose to believe. So consider this deeply and find a method of inner exploration that works for you. There's many different. I'm not saying that OBEs, that self-initiated OBEs is it. There's many ways. Most people today are using deep meditation. But find a method that resonates for you and become a daily practitioner, not a believer. Only through personal experience will we ever truly know the answers for ourselves. And that's what counts. It doesn't matter what I say. It matters what you do. Because only through your own personal experience will you discover that what I've said here is absolute truth. And that we can accelerate our own evolution beyond the biological body, beyond the form-based body, beyond all of the outer dimensional bodies that we're using, because we're incredible beings. We're currently projecting our consciousness through the entire universe to be sitting in this chair today. Through multiple layers of dimensions and thought, right now, you're projecting your consciousness into a temporary biological body to perceive and to hear this message. Because we are a microcosm of the entire universe. We are the path home, because it's an inner path within ourselves. Discover the method that works for you and explore it. Make it a daily practice. Become an explorer of consciousness, not a reader of consciousness, and certainly not a believer of consciousness. An explorer. It's essential. And it's an exciting journey. And I like to add one other thing. It's not only exciting, it's mind-blowing. It opens up realms that I cannot even begin to try to describe to you. It's beyond human conception what's possible, that we have that's available to us. And the only thing that's limiting us is us and our beliefs and our self-concepts and all the stuff that we have attached ourselves to. In a sense, it's time for humanity to grow up and learn about the true nature of what we are and where we're headed, especially in this day and age. It's essential that we become mature, experienced explorers of consciousness. Anyway, I'd like to thank everyone for being here tonight. I appreciate everyone's presence. I know a lot of you come great distances to be here, and I appreciate everyone's being here. And just for a moment, I'd like to open it up just for a brief time for Q&A. Anyone had any questions about any of these topics? Yes.
Would you comment on what exercises you might have on the three-day program?
The new program?
Yes.
Oh, we will explore a lot of, number one, we're going to cover preparation for the afterlife. We're going to cover the creation of a spiritual directive, which I feel is very important. A lot of us know that we have living wills and all this, but very few people think about the concept of creating a spiritual directive for your loved ones so that they know exactly how to approach your spiritual or, let's say, non-physical or exploration needs, whatever term you want to use. That's covered. What as far as techniques, I will be incorporating some of them will be OBE influenced techniques that will assist us in preparation for this transition of consciousness that we will experience as we enter what is commonly called death. It's a transition of consciousness, a shift of consciousness. I will give people a facsimile, in a way, of experiences that will make them more comfortable with the transition and knowledgeable about the journey of consciousness. For instance, we'll do techniques that will focus on moving to your higher self, focusing on what many people perceive as this spiritual essence of themselves beyond form. And we will do techniques that focus on developing that kind of a mantra, you could call it, of how can I remain focused on this? What can I do to maintain that focus of consciousness to the best of my ability? And of course, there'll be many tools provided in how to do this. How to make your own CD, for instance, that has your own spiritual directive on it, with your own, let's just call it a mantra. What is your highest spiritual goal? Most people don't even think about this. We think about a lot of stuff, but very few people ever really address this. What is your ultimate spiritual goal in this lifetime? What is it? That is what we want to focus on. Let's not get hung up on the phrasing of it. Some people use the term higher self. Some people use spiritual essence. It doesn't matter what we call it. It only matters what it means to you. Develop that focus of attention so that when you meet that transitional point, you will have the proper state of consciousness. Let's look at it objectively. How do most people die? Unfortunately, they die in institutions separated from their loved ones. I'm not making a judgment call here. I know hospice work has done remarkable things. But the bottom line is, we don't die the same way we did 80 years ago. Humans today, most Americans in the West, they die in institutions alone. You don't have your loved ones around you. You're pumped full of medication, are you not? I'm not making a judgment call. It's good or bad. The point is, we have to be prepared for what is to come. It's no longer the same as it used to be for humanity. And we have to learn how to deal with these issues. We have to create our own spiritual directive so that not only our loved ones, but the medical staff knows what we expect from them. It's very important. Anyone else? Yes.
How does this relate to the lucid dreaming techniques? For example, the objective seems to be the same, a self-realization through the lucid dreaming route. Now, I see a parallel here.
Yes, there is.
Yes. I'm just questioning.
Okay. I'm glad you mentioned that. The Monroe Institute has a wonderful program devoted to lucid dreaming, just to give them a little plug, that is available here. I cover lucid dreaming a little bit. I focus on self-initiated OBEs in my workshop. Lucid dreaming is another portal to these experiences. I feel they're just as valid and just as important. I think that we can take control in our lucid dream. I'm a lucid dreamer as well. I journal exhaustively on every experience I have. And a lucid dream is a very valid inner exploration of consciousness. And what it gets, to me, it gets interesting. We have the ability, and I write about this in my first book, Adventures Beyond the Body, that we can actually take a lucid dream, and I call it dream conversion, or the Buddhists call it dream awakening. We can take a lucid dream. What is a lucid dream first? A lucid dream is a dream where you have a percentage of conscious awareness is present. Let's be clear on what we're talking about here. A typical dream, it's like, you don't have any real knowledge or control of what's going on. And when you become lucid, you become aware of your environment. You begin to think a little more rationally about it. This is a very important stage or step in consciousness because you are bringing a portion of your conscious awareness into that experience. And when we do that, that's the opening of consciousness. That is the point where we can expand upon that. In other words, if you become lucid in a dream, you can also demand to experience, this, your higher self. You could demand to have a fully conscious out-of-body experience. I've done this many times. I teach it. We can take a lucid dream and in the lucid dream state firmly, now I'm aware, or awareness now. We can upgrade the lucidity or conscious awareness of that dream state and to the point where we are fully conscious and fully aware. That's what makes lucid dreaming so fun and so exciting, because the potential of it is unlimited. I feel it's a very important, let's just call it awareness step. And the Buddhists have been talking about this forever in their dream awakening that's been talked about in many books that are now bestsellers. So yes, I feel that lucid dreams are very important to our entire stage, but don't just settle for that. Take it another step is what I'm saying. Take that lucidity and push the limit. Always push it. No matter how aware you are. The only thing that we take with us, and I like to say this is an important point that I really haven't covered. What do we truly take with us? We only have one thing. We're so in our physical culture, we're so obsessed with these objects around us. You know, it's all meaningless junk. We only have one thing. That's our state of consciousness. Think of it. The only thing that we truly possess and we will take with us is our state of consciousness. It's the only thing that matters. Everything else is just a game. It's just junk along the way. When we die, nothing will come with us but our entire state of consciousness. This is why it's so important that we hone our ability to focus our conscious awareness through lucid dreams or a part of that aspect. You're aware in a dream. That's a wonderful step. Oh my God, I'm fully aware. It's exciting. Fully aware. But then take it even further. I want to be even more aware. Awareness now. spiritual awareness, use whatever term you want, higher self awareness now. It doesn't matter what the terms are. It matters what your intention is, because intention drives consciousness. Intention is the driving force. And once we know that and we hone it, we can begin to focus on the one thing we possess, which is our state of consciousness, because it's the only thing we possess. So to not give it the attention it deserves is insanity. And that's the problem with humanity. They're so extremely focused on everything but this. They're focused on all the external trivia around them and all of this stuff that is meaningless dribble, when the only thing that matters is developing your own state of consciousness to the most that you can achieve in this lifetime. Because it's all we have. It's so critical. One other thing I'd like to mention in this exploration that's so important I haven't shared. This is fun. This is fun stuff. This is not, I sometimes get a little serious. Just a little tad. But this is fun stuff. This is exciting. This opens up a whole new dimension of reality that's hard to, I can't even share it fully, because it's just so expansive. It's fun. And Bob Monroe said it best, probably. Bob Monroe, one of his best statements he ever made was, just have fun with it. Just have fun. Because unless you're having fun with it, you're not going to continue this journey. I think it's fun. I think it's fun to have the vibrational state. I think it's fun to feel myself floating. I think it's all these experiences. These are fun. These are exciting. These add another whole dimension to your existence. Now, granted, you may not be able to share it with some of your loved ones, because it's going to be a little bit, to the uninitiated, it may seem a little strange. It doesn't matter. We have to be individual explorers of consciousness, but have fun with the process. Find a method or an approach that is fun for you that you can do daily, because it's essential that we do this daily, this process, because it's about our inner process. Because it takes time to let go of all the subconscious conditioning we've accepted among ourselves. It takes time to let go of all these beliefs that's sunk into our subconscious mind. It takes time and some effort to begin to unwind all these belief systems and to look at them for what they are, until you realize, I don't need this stuff anymore. They're all anchors to my personal state of consciousness. It's liberating. One of the most liberating things I have ever done is when I realized a few decades ago that every belief I'd ever learned was a crock. Every single one was flawed. Everyone. If I'm not human, it's the basis of society is that I'm human. If that's flawed, what else may be flawed? Think of it. Everything. But it's fun, because it opens your mind to the potential of what we are. And we're amazing. We're amazing, multidimensional spiritual beings with no limits, if we just opened our own potential. And that becomes fun. Anyone else? How's my time? Yes.
I have a dream. And this is a great dream. And I'm very glad when I think about this dream. When I start to live it, it becomes a bad dream, a nightmare. When does my consciousness has created this bad dream? When my consciousness has created the illness, the accident?
Think of it. Thoughts are energy, and they're projected and all projected energy has an impact. We are creating challenges. We grow, and whether good, bad, or indifferent, we're growing from our own challenges. We're growing from our own conflicts. That's what we're doing all the time. We have to acknowledge a bad dream is a message. I think all dreams are a message. Now, what we perceive as bad or good, that's the framework that we're working with. But it's reaching out for you to address an aspect of yourself, is it not? Is it not an aspect of yourself that's grabbing you for attention, that it must be, on some level, you must focus upon this issue and resolve it? That's what I feel that is. And it manifests in many different ways. I use the analogy sometimes for instance, in shamanism. For those of you who've ever done shamanic practices, and I've done my share of them over the decades, and I've been involved in deep shamanic practices where people began to manifest their own fears. They manifest them even in the physical. And you see people in deep trance states start brushing their legs and arms. That's because they're seeing snakes. They're seeing images, fear-based images are beginning to, let's just say, attach themselves to them. These are external. To them, it's very real in this altered state. But what is this? It's a reflection of our own fear being manifest, even in the outer world. Everything is coming from the inner to the outer, and we have to address it and shed light on it. The more light we shed on, let's just call it a bad dream, the more light of consciousness that we can shed on this, the more we can resolve that issue and it will go away. But we must address it. We must confront it, I feel. Ignore it, it just repeats itself. Anyone else like to? Yes.
Okay. One thing that you haven't addressed, or at least I didn't hear it. I took guidelines here a few years ago, and I had an experience. I can call it unconditional love, but that just seems like too small. It was being in and a part of a field of incredible love, where fear just washed away. And it's, I'd say I'm still 2.5 years later, I'm still processing it, but so much of it has changed in me. And I've had many out of bodies, but I never had an experience so powerful. Since then, I've spoken to a lot of people who have had NDEs, and many people here who have also encountered this unconditional love that's just, there are no words for it.
Yes.
So how does that, I didn't hear that, as in your continuum, I guess.
Oh, okay.
Maybe, where would you put that?
Well, I think when people, and that's a commonly, I've had these experiences, many people have, we're connecting with that our true self. I think that is a connection to our true self of what we are. We are unconditional love. We are, that's what we are. We have no form. That's kind of what I was getting to. I didn't use the word love, but that's what we are, I feel. We are pure I-ness. And love, so to speak. I don't know, the word just, I kind of shy from the word sometimes because it's lost its meaning in our society, like soul or heaven. But that's what I feel, you're connecting to that, your true self. I really do.
My feeling, when you said, what do you want to do to be spiritually in this life? I just want to be love, period.
Okay, then that is your goal. That would be your mantra that I would suggest in your, you know, in your journey. And it's a very powerful mantra. Yes.
Thank you very much. Now for a total change of pace on this. A couple of years ago, I was asked a question that was very much related to a married couple who were working on having joint out-of-body experiences. I've got two questions. One is, do you have any experience with that? And number two, the question I was asked was, would this affect the sexual virility of the male? So, that was what I was asked. I wasn't sure how to answer.
Yeah, in 1 minute. Yeah, that is. I just can't imagine that affecting that. I personally cannot imagine it, but you know, if you believe it does, it would. That's what I. That would be my answer. Otherwise, absolutely not. Remember, we're not sexual beings, really. At our core, we're beyond that to begin with. That's what we're just talking about, this idea of pure love. I mean, we exist so far beyond these concepts of duality. And that's what we're still talking about. Concepts of duality, of form-based reality. We exist beyond all of these concepts. But it's up to us to experience it and know for ourselves. One thing I'd like to share just in closing is this. The more that we connect with this higher, call it what you will, this amazing multidimensional aspect of ourselves, call it spiritual, call it pure love, call it whatever you want, but the more that we connect with that, the more that the pathway becomes wider and more open for us to experience it more often, and also at the great transitional point that we call death. That's why these experiences are so important that we have now. Because everything we do now reflects into the afterlife. Everything. You take your beliefs. One of the things that I discovered that was a little bit shocking is that we take our entire state of consciousness with us. It doesn't matter what you choose to believe. Reality doesn't care what you believe. It just is. It doesn't matter if you believe that Mickey Mouse is God. It doesn't matter. Because it just is. So we have to, the more that we prepare ourselves by our own out-of-body experiences or our spiritual experiences or by our deep meditation experiences where we connect with this, let's just call it pure love or pure spiritual essence of ourselves, the more that we connect with that now, the more that our inner pathway is open for us to experience that at the transition of death. And we will not be deceived by the form-based images that will surround us. We will not be deterred by these, let's just call them illusions, that may crop up. We will know our path. We will know how to get there. And this is critically important to the entire evolution of humanity. The problem is that so few people understand this, I feel. And they connect with every form-based belief system and object that you can imagine. We always create the anchors, and we must break the chains and the anchors, for only we can. Yes?
Do you believe that we're going into a more spiritual age than we have been in the past?
Oh, no. No, I do not. I know there's a lot of people believe that. I have found no evidence of that. What is the history of humanity? War. Conflict. That's what I was saying earlier about what is the purpose for this reality. It's a training ground. It's a harsh training ground. That's what it truly is. Yes, it can be pleasant. Yes, we create our reality. But for most people, it's a pretty rough ride. And it's not going to become some panacea. That's not the intent. The intent is for us to learn and develop and grow and then move on. If anything, without going into too deeply, definitely not. Jeez. A lot of people don't like this answer. There are a lot of people don't like it. Everybody would like to believe that. You know why? Because we are so attached to our biological bodies. Think about it. We're so attached to our biological bodies. We want panacea and heaven to be on earth, don't we? Because we're so attached to this. Once you recognize the fact that this is just a vehicle, an outer shell that is expendable at any time, and you put it in perspective, it's all about perspective. spiritual perspective, from that perspective, I feel that this is just, this temporary facade is just a training ground. Look, I have said something even stronger, and I'll say it now. If the entire earth was to be destroyed right now, no one would die. Think about it. It's kind of a mind blower, but nobody would die. Think of it, because we're not biological bipedal animals. That's not what we are. Everybody would continue in another vibrational level of reality. Nobody has ever died. Consciousness has never died. It never will die. That's by thinking in those terms, you begin to put it in perspective and you begin to lose the attachment to, oh, this is important. This stuff is all important here. I got news for you. It's really, it's the training ground, and there's many. Imagine, think of this. There could be billions and billions of other realities like this. We're certainly not the only one. There's a trillion galaxies, billions of planets. To think that we're the only ones is silly. And we have to look at the source of consciousness and what we truly are, and then put things into perspective. Yes.
Yes. You said in your answer on the previous question, that's not the intent. Whose intent?
I'm sorry, I didn't understand.
You said as an answer on the previous question, that's not the intent. My question is, whose intent?
What is the intent?
Whose intent?
The intent comes from whom?
The intent comes for our need to evolve through form. We, as a collective consciousness and as an individual consciousness, we are creating a training ground, I feel. We are the intention. From a higher, I'm talking about from a higher, I'm not talking about from a human perspective. I'm talking about from a, let's call it a spiritual perspective. We are creating this training ground. Let's look at it this way. And some of you are like, well, what does he mean? As pure consciousness or soul, we would never, whatever term you want to use, how would we as pure consciousness ever experience the concept of separation or courage? There's no need for courage in the perfect realms of, let's just call it spirit. There's no conflict. There's no wars. There's none of that. The only way you can internalize the spiritual attributes of an advanced soul is to experience these attributes. And these attributes, only way you can internalize courage is to experience courage by putting yourself in a situation where you have to experience and express courage. The soldier in the foxhole who jumps on the grenade is experiencing and internalizing courage by saving, self-sacrifice of himself. We can't have that experience in the spiritual realm. There's no death. There's no bodies. There's none of that. How can you internalize all these great attributes of a mature, well-rounded, spiritually mature soul, evolved soul, if you don't experience them? Like I said, we learn by becoming what we wish to learn, and we do so through internalizing these experiences. How can you know self-sacrifice if you've never done it, if you never experienced it? I know it sounds bizarre, but that's my take on the evolutionary process. And remember, we're immortal. It doesn't matter if it takes 1,000 or 1,000,000 incarnations. Think about it. We're immortal. Yes, now it's at, oh my God, I can't wait. This is it for me. Everybody, this is it for me. I'm not coming back. No way, Bill. I'm not doing this. We're immortal. You have to put it into perspective. We're learning through experience. And it doesn't matter. The time is immaterial. We can't even wrap our head around the idea of immortality. Imagine it.
Boring.
Boring. Boring. Anyway, I'm trying to explain things in a way that some of these concepts are a little surreal, I know. Anyone else before we break? I would like to thank everyone for being here today. Again, I'd like to thank all of you. Appreciate your presence. And I hope to see you in a future class at some time. So thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you.